This podcast is brought to you by Free Buddhist Audio, the Dharma for your life. Our work is funded entirely by donations from our generous listeners. If you would like to help us keep this free, make a contribution at freebuddhistaudio.com/donate. Thank you and happy listening.
Sisters and brothers, good morning and Jai Bhim to my Indian friends. How lovely to be here to see you all. I can see you because they upped the lights a little bit so I could see you and so you can see each other at this rather nice moment of being together. Can I just ask, just following on from a little precedent that Parami set last night, if you were there in 1976, do you want to stand up? And I know that there are people who were there who are not here today. A lot of us are still around, still alive, mercifully, and still very much involved. It was an amazing experience to be there on that occasion to hear Bhante talk, outlining this vision, which perhaps in seminar contexts and other places he'd outlined, you know, in various ways over the months and years. But in that talk in 1976, or that series of talks in 1976, he really laid out the vision in a comprehensive way. And to be sitting there, and well, for Santra and I were there. Had you joined us in Croydon by then, in Purley by then? Okay. But, you know, there were some of us sitting there with a little van load of people who just started to get involved. Some new, younger people than the sort of old regulars had started to get involved with us at Aryatara community in Purley. And to be able to put them in a van and bring them to Brighton to hear these talks, to hear Bhante speak to us in this way, was, I think, you know, for some of them, life-changing, and some of them are still in the order. So there was Bhante's manifesto, there was his plan, there was his vision, these four talks. Now, I'm going to jump forward to 1989, jumping forward 13 years. And the sort of vision that Bhante outlined in those four talks, you could say, was coming into full flower. There were 300 order members by then. When he gave the talks, apparently there were just 80. So jumping forward to 1989, there were 300 order members worldwide. A lot of people by then were living in communities, were forming this nucleus in the order, living together, starting the beginnings of what we called our new society, working together at centres, working together in businesses, living together, and so on. The world, the three C's, as we called them, had emerged and was in full flood. The three C's being, for those who don't know, centre, community, and in those days, co-op, which now we talk of as team-based right livelihood. Now, what was I doing in 1989? I was on a convention at Stonyhurst, and a little bit before that, a year or two before that, I'd been to a conference in America, in Ann Arbor, Michigan, with Manju Vajra to sort of represent the movement and the Karuna Trust. And I think it's fair to say that in the various opportunities we had to speak and engage in conversations with people, we were sort of the stars. People just kept coming up to us and saying, "Good Lord, you know, what Sangharakshita seems to be doing, the way he's thinking, he's streets ahead of the rest of us." You know, that was terribly exciting, terribly, you know, arrogant-making. but what was really also interesting about that conference was how many Buddhist movements in America, and the conference was called, or the convention was called World Buddhism in North America. What was really interesting was that a lot of American Buddhist movements were in some kind of trouble. You know, some of them were in decline, some were in crisis, some were exploding and sending their followers, somewhat disillusioned with institutional Buddhism, into a kind of free fall out there in the wider world. So it became obvious to me at that conference that just because you're a spiritual movement doesn't guarantee, you know, an unending progress towards, you know, joy, prosperity, universal enlightenment. Things can go wrong. Things can challenge the development of a Buddhist movement. So on that convention, I gave a talk, which I think I called Living in Interesting Times. That being an allusion to the Chinese curse, may you live in interesting times. And I highlighted some elements that out there in us that could impact on our future growth over the coming years. And I talked about the size and identity of the movement, shifts in the world economy, shifts in our surrounding ideology, the changing and maturing Buddhist, Western Buddhist world or modern Buddhist world, the effect of what I called the biological clock, meaning by that the fact that we were getting older. And most of us were still in our 30s when I gave that talk. Most of my audience was in its 30s. But, you know, I envisaged the fact that youthful idealism, youthful energy would probably decline. And, of course, many of us were entering, you know, that rather dangerous period where midlife crises happen. So I talked a little bit about that. And I talked about the fact that, of course, Banti was aging, was going to gradually withdraw and would eventually die. So that was the talk I gave on that occasion, outlining, you know, my thoughts about potential challenges. And I was invited in 2002 to return to the theme. And I gave a talk on a men's event, a men's order weekend at Padmaloka. And here I am again, being asked to return. This is, by the way, the third in a series of 10, each being 14 years apart. What? My predictions were pretty accurate, actually. Even in 2002, I was able to pretty much tick all the boxes except one, where I pointed out that there hadn't been yet many resignations in the order. And it was interesting last night to hear, you know, that is becoming more of a feature of our life. I think when I spoke in 1989, I was dealing with what the sage Donald Rumsfeld would call known unknowns. We took our future for granted, you know, but there would be things impacting on us. And they were fairly easy to guess, even if the outcomes weren't always going to be obvious. I think now it's different. I think now I'm going to be in the realm of unknown unknowns to some extent, but I'm going to have a go at it. I'm going to offer some reflections on our project, some reflections on how we're getting on with the vision that Banti offered us back in 1976. And I offer my reflections with a lot of humility for your reflection, your discussion, and even hopefully, or sometimes, and hopefully not in others, your contradiction. I'm not going to slavishly follow all my headlines from that time any more than I'm going to slavishly follow the outline of the four talks, but I hope you'll see that, you know, you've got something that does fit together and cover the territory. My first theme, though, in 1989 was the size and identity of the movement. I predicted that it would grow and talked about some of the implications of that. And just for your interest, just a few quick statistics. In 1976, Banti referred to the fact that there were 80 members of our order. In 1989, during my talk, I referred to the fact that there were now 300. So the order had almost quadrupled in size in those 13, 14 years. In 2002, when I spoke, I referred to the fact that there were now 1,000 members of the order. So the order had tripled in size. Now, I'm told, there are 2,000 order members, which means that in the last 14 years, the order has doubled in size. It's an interesting point to just pause and note. Our rate of growth is slowing down as a total order. However, if you take into account that since the early days, there are far more Indian order members, so there is an explosive growth there. And if you take into account that the proportion of women order members has grown enormously in those years, I mean, I'm looking now at a far more mixed audience than I did in 1989, what's happening to the men? Oh, we were so cocky, weren't we? Where are we now? But leave that aside for the moment anyway. We are still growing. And some centres are even managing to attract and keep younger and younger people. It was just fantastic yesterday to sing happy birthday to somebody who's entering their 25th year. Back in 89, when I sort of envisaged the growth of the movement, when I sort of, the only kind of challenge I pointed out was that as the movement grew and spread around the world, we might find ourselves falling into national ghettos. In 2002, I said, well, that's not really happened. Perhaps the biggest difference around in the order is the difference between, you know, our Indian movement and, in a way, the rest, and talked a little bit about the cultural mismatches that we can bump into if we're not careful. But as a whole, our movement was pretty well bonded. You know, our international going for refuge retreats and processes brought people together at Mitra and ordination time. Windhorse trading, of course, was, you know, was a hugely bonding experience for people from all over the world. There were various ways in which we could still come together and be very much one movement. I think it's worth pointing out that things now are very much more diverse and in a way more complex. We have probably far greater differences in lifestyle than we had when I started this series in 89. Differences of nationality, of culture. The gender factor is much more of a consideration. But so is age. You know, we have a range from 25 to, I know Abaya will be 80 in just a little while, and I don't know if there's anybody else over 80, but the age range with... Yeah? Oh. So Ratnashuri and, of course, Sangharakshita. So there's an enormous age range in the movement. There's probably a diversity of spiritual experience that back in 89, you know, we didn't have. You know, a lot of us have been practicing in various ways and with varying degrees of aptitude and success. So there's probably quite a variety of spiritual experience and spiritual, if you like, attainment. And, of course, there's also, and this I think is really quite important, there's quite a range of, if you like, distances from the source. You know, in 1989, there was Banti and us. Now, you know, there's Banti, there's us, there's the people we taught, the people they've taught. You know, we are now in a world where we're generations away, in some cases, in some places, from where it began and from, you know, the launch, the source of Banti's Adhisthana. And people have... it's not just that people are at those different points, but they've grown up in different worlds. Worlds where perhaps the chair and the ruling body are old farts like me, and you know, other centres where perhaps the order members are relatively young and new to the order. Is this going okay, Yasho Sagar? How you doing? Yeah, okay. Somebody rub him down occasionally with it. As the movement's grown and diversified in this way, energy is being put into the architecture, the development of the college, the International Council, three threads meetings, and so on and so on. That's very much work in progress. We're developing necessarily all kinds of ways of organising ourselves so that we consult each other, communicate with each other, keep a broad oversight of what's happening, and, if you like, a top-down look at the current state of our commonality. But, you know, with Windhorse Trading gone, with the development of regional GFR retreats and processes, even regional conventions, even now regional preceptors' colleges, you know, you know, things are broadening out even at that sort of level. And I've not mentioned, although Parami did and Banti did, social media. When I gave my talk My follow-up talk in 2002, I think a young man called Mark Zuckerberg was still at school just down the road from Arialoka at Phillips Exeter. Facebook still wasn't around. You know, just think of that, what's happened in those years. So now with Facebook, with things like TED Talks, with all kind, with email, of course, which was around, but it's just more and more prominent. The kind of networking that goes on in the order and movement is far more atomized, in a way far more random, far more freeform. You know, it's possible for individuals to communicate. It's possible for interest groups to form and share their thoughts, their discoveries, if necessary, their complaints. So with something that we've occasionally touched, and apart from the microphone, in our world, and hopefully, it's something that will growl rather than erupt. Is a level, a kind of tension between, if you like, the top down and the bottom up. Between, in a way, the organisation, the institutional organisation of the movement, and the inevitable sort of onrush of democratic ways of connecting with each other. Hopefully, that can just be extremely rich, exciting, and inspiring for all of us. Hopefully, it won't lead to problems. And think, for the time being, we're all so close to the source. Tubandi, he's still alive. Here we are. We are still in pretty good contact. We are still relatively small. I think there is and will be for a while a high degree of commonality. And as we work on the architecture, the institutional architecture of the movement, with more consultation, more representation and so on, hopefully things will just get better. But it's worth bearing in mind, when I gave my talk in 1989, it was just before the final, what shall we say, resolution of what had been happening in Croydon. For 10 years, the centre lurched, through, the talent and, in some ways, the strength and power and charisma of a very gifted order member, until it developed its own emphases, its own culture, some of which, became increasingly problematic, even abusive. That happened in London. It happened here in the UK, right back in those early days when a meeting of chairs would be just about 12, 13, 14 of us. So it's worth remembering that our coherence is fragile, our coherence is vulnerable. As time and distance separate us from each other, something I've noticed just traces of and feared is that with less contact can come a felt need, or less of a felt need for contact. Is it possible that just through almost carelessness we can drift apart? Sometimes when I've spoken to people in other countries, there's often been a tension. Single-sex activities have almost always been seen as an English solution to an English problem. Maybe it is. There's always been that kind of negotiation to be had. But I was very interested back in the time after Yasho Mitra's letter, when I talked to people about, abroad, about how had that gone. Something that I heard from a lot of people, after they explained that for them it hadn't been much of a problem, often they would finish with a phrase like, but anyway, here in our country, we're going to have to work it out our way. And it was well-intended, it was a fairly, from their standpoint, it was seemed like a rather obvious thing to say, but in it seemed to be the seeds of atomization, separation. Of course, every country, every centre has to work out their own plan, their own vision, and how they do our thing. But if it becomes too unlatched from the source, then I think we could drift apart. I just want to throw in one very modest proposal at this point. Now, I'm not a Luddite. When I gave my talk in 1989, several people said, why are there holes down the side of your paper? I think I was the second order member to buy his own computer. I think I was the third to go to use email. So, you know, I'm not a Luddite or a dinosaur, but I do want to suggest that for all the incredible, amazing work that Chandradasa does and pals at Free Buddhist Audio and thebuddhistcenter.com, I really, really wish we had a paper magazine. Aryaloka, which is the centre, you know, on the east coast of the States, have had for a little while a 28-page A4 magazine that offers people some, you know, some of our Dharma, some feature articles on our Dharma, some news about the centre, but also news about the rest of the world. And it's fantastic. You know, people there walk into the centre, and even though none of the order members now working at Aryaloka have lived in the UK, even, you know, some of them are no longer even disciples, to use the word, of the original order members from England and New Zealand who worked and lived around Aryaloka. Here's a magazine that any beginner walking into the centre can see and read and know what they've just walked into. And, you know, there it is on a coffee table, you know, and it's something that someone has actually decided consciously to put together. I'd love to see us have, you know, I know I did it and I'm not going to do it again, folks. 25 years of the newsletter and Golden Drum were enough. But I really would love to see somebody take on that challenge. I do put this across seriously. I think it's you know, something that could make a very, very big difference at kind of grassroots level. I do fear, you know, that with time, if we're not careful, if we're not conscious, we can thin the links between us and between us and the source, and have less of a centre of one order, one sangha, one project. And to be part of that has been hugely inspiring for me, and I think my friends who've been on this ride, you know, to feel that we are all participating in a common project, in a common way. I'm going to say something now about lifestyles, and in a way that covers maybe some of the themes like the biological clock, economic changes, and ideological shifts. In 1973, during a seminar on the Bodhicharavatara, you know, Bhante for the first time used the term the suprapersonal force. He talked about the bodhicitta, the bodhisattva, and bodhicitta not being the property or the attainment of an individual. It's inappropriate to think of it in that way. And he steered the participants on the seminar towards thinking that the bodhicitta could most effectively be thought of something that might start to manifest when a team come together in the right way, in the right spirit, for the right kind of project. In January 1974, at the first convention that I won't ask people to stand up, but about 24 of us were at, Bhante sort of said, well, don't think I'm going to be doing all the teaching forever. You know, you've got to be teaching. You could even think of starting centres yourselves. I can remember Ashwajit laying claim to Bristol. And then in 1976... he gave his series of talks, Buddhism for Today and Tomorrow. So he'd been thinking about this, working in this sort of way for some years. I remember in 1977 when our Croydon world was beginning to erupt and new communities forming, new businesses forming, and up the road, of course, a much, much larger project was taking place at Sukhavati, with the Pure Land Co-op and the building team and the centre. I remember Bhante talking specifically about the development of Sukhavati in the London Buddhist Centre, that being by far the bigger project. He sort of chuckled and said, do you know, I think there are quite a few people who think that when we finish building Sukhavati, we can all just go back into the shrine room and get back on with our meditation and be nice and comfortable. Around the same time, he also gave the teaching on what he termed the bitendential value of being. And I've been surprised how often I've mentioned this to find that the people don't know what I'm talking about. So in a couple of sentences, the teaching suggests that in that, the spiritual life consists in the overcoming of distinction between self and other, then one might as well work on the other end of the spectrum as the self end of the spectrum. In one way or another, you know, Bhante was constantly steering us towards collaboration, towards teamwork, to coming together and thinking of spiritual life and spiritual endeavor as working with others for the sake of all. Now, obviously, this is a valid teaching. That teaching of the bitendential value of being is a perfectly valid, important spiritual teaching in its own right. But in giving us this direction, Bhante was giving us an astonishingly powerful project to engage in. If you like, a powerful myth. There was the myth, if you like, of higher evolution, of personal growth. But we were all just as equally and strongly, I think it's fair to say, engaged with the myth of building a movement, of collaborating together to build something, our centres, our universe, our businesses and so on, for the sake of the world. Maybe Bhante was just simply trying to leave us, some of us young Westerners, out of our habitual self-preoccupation. When I travelled with Bhante in India in 1982 on his tour through Maharashtra, one day at breakfast I asked him, when people get involved here, do you stop talking about, you know, being a better father, being a better husband, contributing to your community, and then you start talking about individual spiritual development once they're caught and engaged? And he laughed at me, and he said, "Well, you're just talking like a psychologically oriented Westerner. It's just your way of seeing things. It's just your way of seeing the spiritual life." I found that a very important and thought-provoking statement. You know, I was, after all, a member of the me generation, as it was put. No, it wasn't about us. It wasn't about me. We were engaged in something much, much bigger. I think we know that Bhante's plan, his vision, was definitely affected by his acquaintance, his contact and communication with Dr. Ambedkar, and his involvement in the movement of mass conversion. Now, something that really struck me when I was writing my book about all that, Jai Bhim, was that Dr. Ambedkar wasn't just interested in helping the Dalit people. He wasn't just interested in helping the oppressed. He saw in that community a grouping of people who were not yet caught in the sort of net of consumerism and materialism. If anything, they were the victims of it and possibly would become even more so. But in a sense, what he was offering to his people wasn't just a path to transformation, confidence, spiritual and, in time, material growth. He was seeing them as the saviours of India. India was a sick country. And if this community of people could take the opportunity of their position in history to practice the Dharma and really make it something, they could actually change the world, not just their community. And I think, you know, when we got involved with the movement, it was easy to think of Bhante as a really nice, wise man just coming to minister to us, the worried well. But not all of us were worried or well, but you know what I mean. But no, I think he saw in us this tiny little envelope opening in time where there was a group of people, some of whom were available, some of us could be accessed, not just for our own sake, but to change the world. He was and is a man on a mission. The outcome of all this, of course, was our new society, the world of the three C's, a total Buddhist life. Literally, you know, many of us lived in communities, many of us worked in our centres and team-based right livelihood businesses, or contributed, engaged in whatever way they could. Even in India, you know, when on those talks that I witnessed Banti giving, he spoke every night about being a 100% Buddhist. Not all these people were going to form communities and team-based right livelihood businesses, but there's no excuse. You know, Banti, of course, you know, had in his vision for the order an order that would be neither monk nor lay. He was handing us an enormous challenge. And I think during that period, where here in England, but not just in England, you know, many, many people, almost the majority of order members, lived that kind of total life, we thought we'd cracked it. We'd cracked the monk-lay divide. Even people who couldn't live that way felt the implicit challenge of the fact that others around them were living that way. I gave a talk around the place called Why the FWBO is Really a Secret Zen Buddhist Movement. And one element of the talk was to point out that our world represented an enormous koan, a problem that couldn't be solved on its own level. So if someone says, can you help out at the centre next Friday, and you've got an arrangement to walk the dog, or if someone says, have you thought of giving up your job and joining us in this project, on one level or another, you know, the movement acted as a constant koan, a challenge to all and everyone. I think for a long time we saw ourselves, we defined ourselves in this way. Such a life was incredibly bonding. It was incredibly intense. It brought some money into the movement. It made it possible to live in that world. And for many, it was a doorway into our world. They would be interested in the businesses we were running and get involved with us for that sort of reason. It was, as Banti put it, the backbone of the movement, that kind of lifestyle. And he referred even at times to the atmosphere of dilute dhyana that he picked up at Sukhavati, where they were building the place. I don't know whether Subhuti is scratching his brow or putting his hand in his face in his hands. I think, you know, Banti was seeing it, and I'm sure he did see that. But also, you know, let's not get carried away. It wasn't always easy. It wasn't always romantic. It wasn't always very grown up. We were, remember, very young. Subhuti has quoted me without credit, you know, without anonymously, for which thanks, but I'll come out. I once said, you know, that I was afraid that I had erected a cathedral next to the foundations of my spiritual life rather than on top of it. I think living that way with that kind of intensity wasn't always easy. You know, sometimes if one's life wasn't balanced enough, if you didn't study enough, if I didn't take the advantage of my friendships to be more open. Looking back, I could have been so much more open and honest about my struggles. It was hard. It was very difficult. It was easy to doubt. It was easy to doubt whether this really was a path to insight. But we were young. It was work in progress. But meanwhile, the world has somewhat caught up with us. The economies have changed. Ideologies have changed. The biological clock has ticked. And many of us are older. Many of us have been through midlife crises of various sorts. And it's had an effect. At present, there are less communities, there probably are less team-based right livelihood businesses around. There probably are less people living that kind of full-time total life as a proportion of the order by a long stretch than there were back in 1989 or even 2002. This is probably one of the biggest changes, one of the biggest identity changes we've had to face, particularly here in the UK. I've had friends who've seen it almost quite literally as the end, and they've started to wonder, you know, well, what's left? What have I got if I haven't got that? We shouldn't be surprised. I think it was pretty clear. One could see the conditions that supported that life at the time, and one could see that they couldn't possibly live, persist forever. But the question is, where do we go now? I think there's all kinds of ways we can go now, and I'll just throw a few of them out. For a start, I, you know, as a president, have always been visiting centres, often abroad, where people haven't been able to live in the way I've just described. And there are some extraordinarily dynamic teams and some extraordinarily bonded teams, even though many of them, I'll sort of discover at some point during a visit, have families and jobs. You know, sometimes I can feel the atmosphere and the communication between people who are working part-time as a centre team. You know, it can be extraordinarily strong. So I wouldn't want to suggest that the only way of doing things is full-time. Then Banti once said, during the interview I did with him on video about some time ago, 2002, he said, what we had, some kind of shard of what we had, some element of what we had in the past, could happen anywhere. Wherever there's a team of order members working together, something could happen. There's nothing to stop people coming together, forming teams, perhaps even in their area, recapitulating something of the world that we knew. After all, there are different ways of doing right livelihood. You don't have to just pack beans or work in a vegetarian restaurant. Virachitta and Sunanda funded the Birmingham Buddhist Centre, the first Birmingham Buddhist Centre, by forming an IT consultancy. You know, perhaps as more people in this room and elsewhere are working out in the world, there could be, as I predicted back in 1989, more people with more skills, more capital, able to restart the vision of team-based right livelihood, but on a completely new and, if you like, higher level. Even those who can't do that. It's worth passing on something that some people did in Auckland. I think there were about eight of them. One of them was the CEO of Penguin Books in New Zealand. Another was a pilot. Another one installed sky aerials on people's roofs. Just a bunch of guys who met, I think, every week, as if they were a team, to report in and share with each other their discoveries, their problems, their learnings from their work. There are other ways of doing it, other ways of finding a way of bonding intensely in the context of one's life. And, of course, as I predicted back in 1989, more people working in different ways outside our world could mean more money. And just look at the car park. In 1980 at Vine Hall, I remember watching a bunch of guys push-starting the purple van. I think that was the only vehicle in the order. Now look. We do need, you know, we do need that world to survive, at least in parts. You know, we do need people who want to, who can, throw themselves fully into that life. I think that koan is necessary for us all. I think that backbone is necessary for the movement. We have to find a way of doing that, of course, where we avoid the monk-lay split emerging, as some people become the full-timers, with the majority of order members not living that way. And I think the challenge before us all will be to live an intense spiritual life, whatever our context, to support and encourage each other and to respect each other in our work in those contexts, and to share our insights and learnings, not to buy into some demoralizing idea that unless you're a full-timer, you're not the full ticket. You know, can we keep also alive that missionary project in one way or another? Back in 1976, you know, Banti definitely outlined his vision of a Buddhist world, the blueprint for a new society. A blueprint for a new world. He envisaged teams of people living that more total life, gradually spreading until there are so many that they coalesce and the old society becomes the new society. Well, maybe it won't happen quite that way, but we can certainly keep at it. There was an image he also offered around the same time when, I can't remember which lecture, someone can remind us later, where he said that he envisaged a magazine called The Earthworm, the suggestion being that any of us, if we were truly individuals, truly inspired, could, in our context, whatever it was, have an effect and draw people towards the Dharma. And, of course, that's the case, whether you're a teacher, a doctor, a lawyer, a politician, a mindfulness trainer, whatever you are, you know, you're in a position through your influence, through your integrity, to draw people towards what it is that's had such a beneficial effect on you. However we do it, the challenge still is to work in harmony with friends and brethren for the sake of all beings. Now, talk a little bit about changes in the Buddhist world. Through the early years of our life, not just in the UK, but I'd say much more broadly, it was as if we were, in some respects, the only game in town. You know, there was very little opportunity to practice and live Buddhism in the UK, in Europe, or I think even for that matter in the USA or India. Little chance, certainly, of finding an accessible, coherent path. There weren't many books. There weren't many teachers who spoke in a contemporary voice. For most of us who got involved with Tri Ratna, or the Friends, as it was then, Banti really was all we knew. And by gum, we knew it. We listened to the tapes of his talks over and over and over again. We listened to them at classes. We listened to them in bed at night. We listened to them on retreats. We slept to them. They just came at us. And I think as a result, you know, actually we got to know a lot of Dharma, and we got to know it through, you know, through Banti's voice. Now, even in 1989 and in, even in 2002, when speaking of our relations with the wider Buddhist world or the impact of the wider Buddhist world on us, I spoke really of diplomatic issues, of what they thought of us and how we got on together. It's different now. Now, there are books, there are Western-style teachers everywhere, there are Western-style groups, and, of course, there's the internet. Voices coming at us with Western voices, very accessible, some of them specializing in particular areas of interest. There's an enormous range from arcane Tibetan to the secular. The spiritual supermarket that we talked about even back in the 70s is still very much alive, and it's just a click away. And this at a time when a lot of order members are maturing. A lot of them are specialising at a time perhaps when some centres are under-resourced in terms of order members with great depth of experience and where that total Buddhist life is unavailable. I think something one picks up sometimes is that there's a kind of doubt that, you know, is relatively new, a wondering of, is our way the only way? Is our way the best way? Is our way enough? Now, sometimes, you know, when I see people tuning into other teachers, even going on retreats with other teachers, sometimes I can sympathise. I know there's been a time when quite a few people in New Zealand have been on a retreat with a Western disciple of a Tibetan teacher, and the retreats sound pretty good. They sound intense. And looking around at what was available to people then in terms of retreats and teachers, I could understand. I could empathize. In a way, it was often people who most sincerely were looking for opportunities for intensity and depth that were drawn in that way. But where it becomes more complicated is where an order member who isn't necessarily terribly experienced, not terribly knowledgeable about what's available in our movement, is trying to start a new group and is looking for study texts to look at, to explore with a new group of beginners in their country or in their town. And it can be very easy to be drawn towards a Pema Chodron or a Charlotte Joko Beck, or you know, somebody who seems to speak in a more accessible, modern voice. And often when talking to people about this, people say, but Bhante seems so English. Bhante is so old-fashioned. And I sort of exploded, sort of, in talking to somebody, a good friend, a few months ago, say, look, when I got involved, I was young, I was cool, I listened to the Pink Floyd. You know, I didn't turn up to a class on a penny farthing with a top hat. You know. I mean, come on, really. You know, it amazes me that there is this idea. You know, Bhante was always weird. I mean, that, you know, that was strange even then. You know? Get over it. Perhaps the very breadth of our sweep lulls people into an idea that it's all a bit of a rag bag. It doesn't matter. Somebody I was speaking to whose allegiance is clearly far greater at present to a Tibetan teacher than to our system, is also teaching beginners at a center. And I said, you know, how is that? And they said, well, it's just Dharma. Well, it's not quite like that. What we have isn't an accident. Bhante brought a very definite vision to what he was doing. He was, you know, a lot of it born out of a critique of what he saw happening in the East and West. He watched us, he commented, he pruned, he encouraged, he selected texts, he communicated with us one-to-one. He's crafted our coherence, our lineages, our emphases out of thousands of observations and reflections. And, of course, his practice, his insight. And he's done it so collaboratively, so organically, that we forget, perhaps we don't even realize, how conscious it all is, how special it all is, how it all adds up to a coherent system of training. It's not a world, a universe of methods. It is a method. And it's tampered with, you know, at great risk. When Bhante published his message, his What is the Western Buddhist Order, in, I think, 2009, I spoke to various people who found it rather harsh and unforgiving. Other people who complained, you know, saying, but it's all so narrow. Does it have to be so narrow? Another thing that astonishes me, I can remember on the very first retreat I went on in 1971 at Kefold's, a bhikkhu turned up and he was just passing through. He wanted to talk to Bhante. And somebody who had had lunch with the bhikkhu later told me that he had told her that if you read his book, The Survey of Buddhism, you had the key to the entire Dharma treasure. Now, do we realize that always? Do we realize what a gift he's given? We do frolic in the vast meadow of the Dharma, but we do it with purpose, with a point. He's given us the Babel fish. No, that one would be lost. he's given us a means of transforming, you know, input from all these traditions into something we can use, we can practice, and know what we're doing. A lot has been said about commonality in recent years, and I know it's not always popular, but my great fear, you know, is that the movement or some centres could just turn into friendly umbrella groups for people with a whole range of different practices and interests, rather than what we have, the beginnings of an entirely new and effective tradition and set of lineages. So as Banti said, you know, even as we do, understandably in many cases, explore what's going on out there, learn from what's going out there, learn from people who've been out there, let's do what Banti asked and keep in touch with each other. Let's talk to each other, test our experience, test our motivation, and share our discoveries. If your practice in another territory with another teacher takes you from the movement with integrity, sincerity, go well. Sadhu. You know, no one said that everyone's got to, no one leaves the room. You know, if you've Other options are available. But, you know, we have our option. And at least give it a chance. Really practice it. Talk about your experience. Let's share. And let's share not just to keep in line, but because, yes, we are learning. We are developing. We are an emerging tradition. When he was staying with us once in Croydon, back in 77, he and I were walking down the road. I've told this story a few times, but I'll tell it again. I asked him whether he thought that Buddhists in the West would ever make use of the power and charisma invested in Christian symbols. And he said, "I have no doubt we will." And then we walked a bit further and he said, probably in 400 or 500 years. Yeah, he knows things will change. He knows that our movement will evolve and grow and develop, acquire new emphases, perhaps some new practices and so on. You know, so let's not think it's all about being conservative. It's about staying as conscious as he's been, as he's developed and crafted our world. Which brings me, in a way, finally to Banti. I spoke of Banti's withdrawal and death back in 89. As if he was the one who was going to withdraw and die. These days, there's a lot of us that could apply to. And when I say, when I want to know who the young people are, you know, it's going to be important to know who's going to be able to mind the shop while the rest of us are at each other's funerals. It's going to be a full-time job. Over the years, Banti has been passing, you know, more and more of his responsibilities on, sharing them, passing them on. But without doubt, he is still at the heart of things. He is our teacher. He was the founder. He has been our preceptor, is our preceptor. He gave those four talks. But it's more than that. He's given us a kind of rock-solid confidence in what we are. It's fascinating listening to his talk on the nucleus of a new society, which he says is just a talk. And he just tells the story of why he founded the order. And tells the story about what happened with the English Sangha Trust, what was on his mind, how it began. And then he says, and the rest is history. This is in 1976. It had only been going 10 years. I mean, that kind of rock-solid confidence in what we did, and if you like, that strong desire to pass that confidence on to us. You know, it's the confidence that's probably kept a lot of us around, just a belief, which, you know, if we're honest, many of us have taken from him, along with other things. You know, whether we would have felt that confidence ourselves without him, I don't know. But it's been so important, as has been his sense of purpose, his sense of urgency, and his sense of mission. I mean, you don't need a Buddhist teacher to tell you that the world is moving into difficult, troubled times. To be alive to the world with some insight, with something to give, you know, this really is a time to remember, you know, that the movement was founded, our order was founded in order to go out and help the world in whatever way it turns out that we can. Bhante has been the bridge between, if you like, the traditional world and our new lineage. When I was editing Golden Drum or the newsletter, I can't remember which, we always used to refer to him as the Ven.Sangharakshita. And at one point he called me into his study. We were having a chat and he said, you've been doing that Ven thing for a while and I think it's okay to drop it now, just as I don't wear robes so much. You know, for a while, it's just been necessary for me to act as that bridge, and I still have to some extent, but gradually, you know, I can perhaps let that go as the movement develops its own confidence and its own tradition. But in the meantime, you know, he has given us that link with the tradition. If you like, with the Buddha, it wasn't Dennis in civvies passing on some stuff he learnt in India. It was a Buddhist monk, you know, and again, that fed our confidence, it fed our vision, and it fed our sense of connection, if you like, directly through the tradition with the Buddha. He's also been a bridge between cultures and languages. In the survey, he talks about the importance of recognizing that Buddhism talks of devas, of dakinis, of the cosmology of kalpas and so on. You know, he opens our eyes to that world, to the mystery, to the transcendental. But he also gives lectures interpreting the stupa, interpreting the Buddha's miracles in human psychological terms. And of course, he's offered us a very kind of Western image of the higher evolution. He's been our definitive thinker, our definitive adjudicator, if you like, the single point of unity for the movement. Even in the hardest, most troubled times in the order, even when they've concerned him, the fact that he's been around has kept us together, has kept us unified. He's irreplaceable. It's all up to us, to some extent, to a large extent already, but as distance grows and as the connections become less clear, it's going to be up to us even more to stay faithful to what he's given us. Somebody once asked me, somebody who was just interested in what I did with my life, he wasn't a Buddhist, not even interested in Buddhism, and after I'd explained it to him, he made a reference to the future and then said, oh, sorry, I was just assuming you do think of this as going into the future, as if it would be perfectly respectable to say, this is what I did with my life and now it's over. I want to say I'm confident that we will be around in 40 years. The order will be around. The movement will be around. I really can't guess. I can't make too many predictions, you might have noticed, because I really can't guess in much detail what form it will take. But I also fear that if we're not careful, we could just literally let it trickle through our fingers by accident. You know, implicit in what I've been saying is this possibility that as time goes by, as distances separate us, as the impact of other teachings come into our world, if we don't do what Bhante asked and practice, share, honour and pass on faithfully what we've learnt, then we could lose it. Just with a whimper, our sanghas could just start to be nice friendly places where Buddhists of various allegiances kind of hang out together. You know, our businesses might just turn into businesses, you know, with no Dharma element, no Kalyanamitra element and so on. Let's hope not. I think not. The fact that we're here, the fact that we all know people who aren't here but who are very fully on board, very fully working for the movement, living their practice, then, yeah, I'm optimistic. But I do feel the need, you know, to issue a warning. You know, as a president of centres all out of this country, I can see what distance can do. I can see, you know, we're in the Meghiya Sutta, you know, I can sometimes see those trifling faults which, if not recognised as such and discussed as such and, if necessary, argued as such, then we could lose it. And what a sad thing that would be. But meanwhile, here we are. Let's enjoy it. I'll be back in 14 years as a sprightly 82-year-old and we'll see how we're getting on. Thank you.
We hope you enjoyed this week's podcast. Please help us keep this free. Make a contribution at freebuddhistaudio.com/donate. And thank you.